based applications which can be done through NI software as well as hardware. So in the morning session, we have just seen how we can how NI platform, okay, NI based systems has an Rio platform hardware which is mainly used for building in real time applications. Okay, so after that we have seen what are the different various types of Rio hardware available in order to make a standalone system. Okay, fine. So later, so we are just introduced into a hardware part. Okay, about a Rio hardware called MyRio. Fine. So if you know how to program with MyRio hardware, okay, if you know how, the steps, okay, the steps which we will follow to write a code, okay, to get the information from sensor through MyRio hardware. Okay, the steps or the methodology will be same whenever you're going to use. If you want to work with PXIs as well as Rio, only few modifications will be there. Okay, a few modifications will be there. Apart from that, dumping, execution, creating a standalone system. Okay, so all are going to be same only. Fine, right? So morning we have seen how to develop a code under RT. Okay, and then we have just seen a small code how to dump the application inside a Rio. Fine, and as we said, once we dump the code inside the Rio hardware. Okay. Once we dump the code using dump the code inside the hardware, so even though if you remove the USB connection, okay, USB connection from your system to the MyRio hardware, the code is keep on executing. But when you remove the power supply, and then if you again provide a power, it's not okay, the application is not working because it is stored in RAM actually, so memory, right? So automatically the program has been erased. Okay, if the power goes, so the next step is, so how we can make, okay, how we can create a standalone system. Okay, that is the next thing we are going to discuss now. Okay, so how we can create a standalone system by using this NI-RIO platform hardware. Okay, fine. So this is what we're going to learn now. Okay, so I'm going to teach you the programming steps. Okay, so how to create a standalone application, and then I'll show the real-time standalone system also. Okay, maybe later part I'll show a video. Okay, it's an automated application which has been built using this NI hardware platform as well as software platform, right? So it's about a pencil sorting application. So have you seen the pencil sorting application before when someone takes any session? Have you seen the pencil sorting application before or during the session? Okay, if no, then no problem. We'll see that later if we have time. Okay, so if I demonstrate everything and if we have time, we'll see that application. Okay, fine. Yes. So now let me share the screen right now, and then only you can see the programming development part. So I'm going to present the screen. Yes, I have shared the screen right now. I hope the screen is visible. You can just look into the screen. Fine. Yes. So the next step is, I'll just move on to the LabVIEW program. Okay, the same code. Okay, whatever the code we have just seen before. Okay, it's about LED blinking. It's about LED blinking. Okay, when I just press the push button, so automatically the LED has to turn on and turn off. Okay, this is what we have done in the before session. Next. Okay, after that, okay, when we try to create a standalone, okay, once we remove the USB connection also, the code is working. But later part, if we remove the if we remove the power, right, and once again if you just provide a power to the MyRio hardware, okay, it's not the application whatever we have dumped, it is erased, it is not running. Okay, next step is what? So we are going to learn how we can create, okay, how we can create a standalone system. Okay, after that, after creating a standalone system, then I'm going to teach you how we can develop. Okay, I'm going to show a demo how we can develop a code. Okay, I've developed a VI under FPGA target. Okay, so under FPGA target, fine. So let me just first try to build a standalone system. Okay, later part we'll move on to the FPGA programming part. Fine. So before this, I'll just save the code. Okay, the code is saved, and then I'm going to save the project too. Okay, fine. So I'm going to close this. Right, I've just closed it now. So I'm going to start from the scratch. Okay, I'm going to start from the scratch. I'm going to explain how we are going to create a standalone system. Okay, so in order to create a standalone system, first we need to create a project. The first step is what? You need to create a project. Okay, see, there is an option called create project. Okay, instead of new, if you just go for create project, it will ask you. Okay, so you'll get a pop-up and then it'll ask what, which type of projects you want to create. Okay, which type of projects you want to create. See, I have an option called MyRio. Okay, so if I just click on MyRio, automatically it will create a project under Rio hardware. If I just click on blank project, okay, you can just directly click on MyRio project also. Okay, so when you click on the MyRio project, right, we just click next. So automatically a project will be created. Okay, so see, it is asking whether the target is plugged through USB, okay, USB or connected through Wi-Fi. Okay, if I just select USB, right, and then if you just give finish, this is a short way to create a project, a short way to create a MyRio project. Okay, fine. So automatically a new project will be created. Okay, so it's creating a new project. See, automatically a new project is created, and then you are getting your target also. And then you're getting a target. So by default, they'll have a main VI. So that VI will have your onboard sensor. Okay, so this VI is nothing but it'll just show the accelerometer values. Okay, there's a program which is already they have developed inside the hardware. Okay, this is going to display the accelerometer value. For example, if I just run, right, so it's going to give X axis, Y axis, and Z axis, 3-axis accelerometer. Okay, which is going to provide the value, and it is plotted in the graph. Okay, see, if I do any variation, if I do any variation with the Rio hardware, automatically that variations will be plotted in the waveform graph. Okay, waveform chart here. Fine. So this is a simple way or the easiest way to create a project. But now we are going to create our own project. We are going to create a build a standalone system. Okay, we are going to build a standalone system. Okay, in order to build the standalone system, okay, in order to build a standalone system, file, I'm going to select new. Okay, so and then it's an empty project. Then you have to click on okay. Fine. Once you click on okay, so now a project has been created. Okay, and then under the project you have my computer. Next step is what? You need to add your target. Okay, the next step is we need to add the target under the project. So in order to add the target, so just right click on your project screen. Okay, and then you can see there's an option called new, and then you have to select target and devices. Okay, you have to select target and devices. When I just click on target and devices, right, see, you have to just, there's an option called existing target or device. Okay, so under this you have to select MyRio. Okay, under this you have to select MyRio because we are going to create an application, or we are going to program in hardware using a hardware called NI MyRio. So you can just select this. Fine. And if you have a compact Rio, if you have a compact Rio, okay, then you can make use of this, a real-time compact Rio system. And if it is connected, okay, automatically that compact Rio will be displayed here. So I'm going to just click on okay. Fine. And now, as I said, right, once your FPGA, okay, the, whenever you want to work with the MyRio hardware, so we have to install LabVIEW software, LabVIEW RT, and LabVIEW FPGA. Okay, all these three should be installed. Then only you can just, depends upon the requirement, you can develop the code in RT or you can develop the code in FPGA. Okay, or if you install only LabVIEW and LabVIEW RT, the only way is what? You can develop the code inside your RT only. You cannot do anything with your FPGA. Okay, so if you want to program in RT or FPGA, so always make sure that LabVIEW RT and LabVIEW FPGA software should be installed in your system. Okay, so then only you can read and write the information. Okay, read and write the information through the hardware. So I'll just, next step is what? Okay, fine. You have to create a new VI. So now I'm going to create a VI under RT. Okay, now I'm going to create a VI under RT. That's why I am going to right click on NI MyRio 1900 new and then select VI. Okay, which means that this project, okay, this VI is under your RT now. See, untitled project 2/NIMyRio. Okay, which means that your project, okay, your VI is under your RT, okay, RT system. Next step is what we know that always we are going to do the program in the block diagram part. Okay, we are going to do the program in the block diagram part. Okay, so now right click, so structure palette. So in order to run any process continuously, okay, whenever you want to run any program in a continuous way, okay, you can make use of while loop. You can just take a while loop and then you can just create a control, okay, so that you can stop the program. Fine. So now if it is a standalone system, it will be running in your RIO continuously. Okay, fine. So now after this, to make the program to run continuously, you can have the stop button next to provide a delay. I hope you know why we are providing a delay, in order to reduce the 100% usage of CPU. Fine. So let me give 100 millisecond delay. Now I'm going to create a standalone system. Okay, I'm going to create a standalone system. I'm having an LED with me right now. Okay, I'm having an LED with me. So I want this LED. Okay, I want this LED to be keep on blinking continuously. Fine. So if you see, I have an LED with me. Okay, I think you can see now. Okay, so I have an LED right now. Sorry. Okay, so I have an LED here. So I'm going to make this LED to blink, okay, turn on and turn off automatically. Okay, so instead of giving any command to the LED on and off, I'm going to develop a program, okay, in such a way that this LED is going to be keep on blinking continuously, and I'm going to make this a blinking application as a standalone application. Okay, so I'm going to make this application as a standalone application. Fine. So now, in order to make this as a standalone application, we are going to develop a code. Fine. So LED, it has two terminals. One is cathode, another one is anode. Okay, fine. So whenever your cathode anode potential is greater than your cathode potential, the LED will get a forward bias, right? The same way here, I'm going to make use of this LED. Okay, so this has two value possibility. One is on and another one is off here. Okay, so automatically this comes under digital family. Okay, so I'm going to first, okay, digital means what? So we are going to give the digital command, okay, to the LED through the MyRio hardware. Okay, so which means that you have totally 40 digital input output pins. You have totally 40 digital input output pins here. Fine, you can make use of any pins among 0 to 40. So now right click, I'm going to scroll down. You have an option called MyRio. So inside this MyRio, okay, I'm going to select digital output, because see, whenever you're trying to read any information from sensor through hardware, it's called read, okay, in, okay, which means some signal or information is coming inside, okay, your system through the hardware. Out means if you're going to send any command, okay, or any information from your application through hardware, it's out. Okay, fine. So now I'm going to select digital out, and then you can just place this digital out here. Okay, so once you place this digital out, fine, you can see here it will show digital output. You can just give whatever the name you want, and you can see here you can select any pins. Okay, you can select A, because we have three ports here, A port, B port, C port. A port has 16 digital pins, B port has 16 digital pins, C port has 8 digital pins. Okay, so I'm going to use right now C port. So just scroll down. So you can just select C/DIO0. Okay, so I'm going to use a 0th, okay, DIO0, right, in your C port. And if you want to give any name here, custom channel name, you can give LED. Blinking. And then if you just give OK, so now automatically your digital output, okay, your 0th pin DIO0 in your third pin will be configured. Okay, DIO0 in your third pin will be configured as digital output. Okay, see, it is showing in green color. Okay, showing in green color, which means that okay, it will accept. Okay, it will accept Boolean as an input. Fine. So now, if I'm going to use one onboard LED also, just to know whether a standalone system is running, it is like an indication. So right click again, MyRio LED. So let me use LED 0, okay, or let me use LED 2. Okay, I'll make this is for indication. Okay, so I'm going to pass a true constant always, so which means that this will be always on. So I want to make my LED to blink continuously. Okay, I want to make my LED to blink continuously. So in order to make my LED to blink continuously, I'm just going to develop a small logic. Okay, I'm going to develop a small logic. Fine. So right click, numeric, quotient and reminder. So I'm going to divide the I value by 2. Okay, so numeric constant, let me take a numeric constant here, let me give so right click visible item, I have something called radix. Okay, it's in decimal. We can give SI notation or else instead of doing all those things, right, a simple way is what I'm going to use a NOT gate. Okay, so I'm going to use a shift register. I hope you people know what is the use of shift registers. Shift registers are used to transfer. Okay, it is used to transfer the values to the next upcoming previous iteration values to the next iterations. Okay, and for example, we know that this loop will run continuously. This loop will work like a do while. Okay, for each and every time, if you connect an indicator to the I, it's going to tell how much number of times your loop has been executed. Okay, at the same time, if I want to access any previous iteration values to the next upcoming iterations, so you can make use of feedback nodes, or else you can make use of shift registers. Okay, so now let me use a shift register. Okay, so I'll be connecting this to the shift register. So which means that now my shift register is configured. Okay, now my shift register is configured to store, okay, the Boolean values. Okay, Boolean value, and then I'm going to initialize my shift register. Okay, I'm going to initialize my memory with the value of false. Okay, so you people already know that LabVIEW follows a data flow programming concept. So data flow programming means your flow of data, okay, is going to determine the order of execution, right? So when I just run the code initially, the shift register memory will be replaced with false value. Okay, so then when you give a false value to the NOT gate, it will become true, and that will be given to LED next iteration when your loop goes for the next iteration. So if you see, the value which is present on the left hand side of shift register will be true, and that will be inverted into false, and then your LED will goes to off state. Okay, so like this, it will be keep on, okay, changing from on state to off state with the help of this and NOT gate here. Fine. And then we have one more function here. You can see it is LED. So this is just to make your first example, if the LED is not working on after dumping, okay, after dumping the code, if the LED is not blinking, we'll think that we have done some wrong logic inside the code. But if you see, if the LED, onboard LED is getting turned on, which means that the standalone application is working properly, there is a problem with the sensor. Okay, so that you can just replace the sensor. Just to know the information, okay, for an identification, I'm making this LED to be always in on state. Okay, so now let me give a connection. So anode terminal will be given to the DIO0 and cathode will be given to ground. Okay, fine. So I'm going to give you connection and then let me show the, I'll show the connection to you. No issues. Okay. Let me give the connection and then I'll show the connection also. So I'm going to use DIO0. Yes, so I'm giving the connection here. So from DIO0. Connection is over. I'll just show it in the camera. No issues. So after this, let me show in camera right now. I'll show the screen. I think it's visible right now, okay, using this hardware. Okay, so I think you can see the hardware right now. Okay, it's my Rio hardware. Fine. Yes, okay. So if you see here, if you see the MyRio hardware, there are two pins are connected, okay, two pins are connected. If you want to look into the pinouts properly, okay, if you want to look into the pinouts, I think now it will be visible. See, for DIO0, okay, for DIO0, I just connected one wire, and then for DGND, DGND corresponds to digital ground, so that I have connected one more wire. I hope you can see the connections also properly. Fine. And then if you look, it is a three pin connector, okay, it is a three pin connector, totally it has three wires, okay, it has three wires, but I'm using only two wires, okay, right? So black, I left it out. And then you can see here the LED is connected to the two terminals, okay. So your cathode terminal is connected to ground and anode terminal is connected to the digital DIO pin 03 in your C port, okay, DIO 03 in your C port. If you want to see, you can check here, see DIO03, it's connected to your C port. Okay, now your connection is done. Okay, the only thing is we have to run the code and then we need to check, and if it works properly we can create a standalone system. Okay, we can create a standalone system. So I'm going to run the code. See, it is deploying. See, once the code gets deployed, okay, once the code gets, while deploying, it will ask you to save the code. I'm going to create standalone, okay, so standalone system. Yes, see, once your deployment is completed, okay, once your deployment is completed, fine, it will show deployment complete successfully. And there is an option called close on successful compilation. If I just select this option, automatically, if next time, each and every time, once it completes its deployment, right, automatically this window will get closed. If there is any error, it will display the information deployment with error, okay, or your code will not get deployed properly. If you just give close, automatically, see, this loop is getting executed, okay, and it is keep on running at a faster rate, okay. So I think the LED is not working properly. Let me check. Okay. So if there is any connection issue also, so ground. Okay, fine. So now the program is running. Okay, the LED is blinking here. So I'll just show the screen right now. You can see, okay, see the LEDs keep on blinking. You can see I have just made the LED to be blinking continuously, and then you can see here the LED. Okay, I have just used one LED, right? LED 2. LED 2 is always in on chip because I have just given a true constant. Okay, fine. So our application is working properly. So now what we're going to do, and there is a loose connection here. Okay, so what we're going to do is, so now we are going to make this as a standalone system. Okay, so now if I remove the USB also, the code is deployed inside, it will work. But if I just remove the power, automatically the code will not work because it is not a standalone system. Next step is what we are going to learn, how to create a standalone system. Okay, we are going to learn how to create a standalone system. Fine. Yes. We'll just do that now. So I'll go back to project. So now your program is working properly. You can just stop your program. Okay. So you can just save this. So we are going to make this as a standalone system. Okay. We're going to make this program as a standalone system. So now, if you want to make any system, okay, if you want to make any program as a standalone system, go to your project window, because all these steps, whatever you're going to do, okay, will be done in this project window only. First step is you have to save the project file, save, okay. Standalone project. Okay, your project is saved. Next step is, okay, next step, if you want to make anything as a standalone system, you can see there is an option called build specification. There is an option called build specification. Just right click the build specification. Okay, right click the build specification, and then you can select new. Okay, you have to select new. And then you need to select real-time application. Okay, I repeat, go to the build specification under MyRio. Okay, right click, you have to, you'll get an option called new, and then in new you have to select real-time application. Once you select this option, okay, once you select this option, automatically a real-time system will be created. Okay, automatically a real-time system will be created. Fine. So after this, you will get a pop-up. Okay, after this, you'll get a pop-up. In this pop-up, okay, in this pop-up, if you see, there is an option called information. Okay, so it is going to see, it is telling, it's going to create a My Real-Time application. Okay, the target file is going to be start.exe, and that is stored in the respective location. Okay, that is stored in the respective location. So under VI Solutions, there is an option called build. Okay, under build, you have standalone, okay, and then your My Real-Time application. Fine. So after this, there is an option called source file. After this, there is an option called source file. So in the, when you just click on the source file, you get this option under this My Real. Now I have only one VI. Okay, so whichever the VI you want to make it as a standalone, just click, and then you have to just select this arrow mark that will be given to be copied to the startup VI. Okay, so startup VI means once your video gets started, automatically this VI will start to execute. How it is working? It's because of having a watchdog timer inside this MyRio hardware. Okay, and then you can see there is something called always included. Now it is not required. You can directly click on an option called build. Okay, so once you click on the option build, automatically see it is building a standalone system. It's a real-time application. Okay, so it will compile, and then it will deploy properly. Fine. It not even takes a minute actually. Fine. Yeah. It is saving. Yeah. So now after this, okay, after this, so that My Real-Time application will be displayed here. See, now it is building a real-time application. Okay, so now it is building a real-time application. And once it is over, okay, once it is over, okay, fine. See, this one, the build is complete. You can locate the build at, okay, and then you have to select done. Now your real time system is built. Next step, okay, next step is what? Whenever a system gets power, immediately you want to make this respective code to be running, okay, continuously. So what you can do is right click on the My Real Time application. There is an option called Run as Startup. Okay, there is an option called Run as Startup, which means that, sorry, first you have to give actually set as startup. Okay, it is automatically given. And then if you have, see now it is unset as startup is there. So when you give run as setup, okay, startup, whenever your program gets power, immediately this application will start to execute. See, it is showing the target must be rebooted. The target must be rebooted for the application to launch. Okay, so I'm going to give proceed with reboot. Yes. Okay, so I want to reboot my system. So automatically your system will get rebooted. So you can just see here, see the system is getting rebooted now. You can see here, see the LED is off. Okay. So once your system gets booted, okay, automatically the respective LED will start to be in on state and the real time, see it is rebooted. And now see the LED is on, okay. At the same time, if you see here, this LED is also blinking. Okay, if you see, this LED is also blinking. Now you can ask the question, sir, remove the USB, okay, connection. Okay, let it be here. See, the LED is blinking continuously. Okay, I'm going to remove the USB connection. Yes, okay, see the USB connection is removed. Okay, still my LED is blinking. Okay, and my application is also running continuously. Okay, LED is also blinking and your application is also running. So next step, what we have to do, we have to remove the power. Okay, we have to remove the power and then we need to check, once we give a power, whether the application is again running continuously. See, I have removed the power. Okay, so I'm going to give the power again. Yeah, you can check, I've just given the power. Okay, again, and we have to see whether the system has an option, okay, whether the system has an option to make this code to run as a standalone system. Okay, so it will get rebooted and then automatically it will start to execute. Okay, it takes some time. See, once it gets rebooted, immediately the LED is blinking. Okay, it's creating a standalone system. And if you see, the LED is also in on state. Okay, so even though if you remove the power and if you provide a power supply, again, the code, whatever we have just deployed. Okay, so it is running. How it is executing? This is because of watchdog timer. Okay, this is because of watchdog timer. So it will automatically restart your system once it gets powered. And then whatever the application we have just stored it, deployed and dumped, so that will be automatically restarted by watchdog timer and your application will be keep on working continuously. Okay, so this is how you can create a standalone system in your Rio hardware. Okay, fine. So if you are doing anything, okay, in a remote area, okay, what you can do, you can just create a standalone system and you can make the application to run continuously. Simple, I can say an example is smart irrigation system. If you have a moisture sensor, it needs to measure the moisture content of the soil. If the moisture content is less, it automatically it should turn on the motor to pump the water. Okay, and if the moisture content is at the normal level, automatically it has to turn off the motor. Okay, right? So it's a simple example. No need to sit near the motor to check the moisture level. So automatically, it depends upon the condition, it will turn on and turn off the motor and it will pump the water to the respective field. This is a simple example, just a small example. Fine. So this is how you can create a standalone system using this MyRio hardware. Okay. So how it is happening? Because we are going to dump the code inside the Rio hardware, because it has an inbuilt FPGA and then processor. And still now, whatever the code we have developed, that code is implemented in your embedded processor, not on FPGA. Okay. So if you want to do something with FPGA, again, you need to develop one more program. Right. Okay. I hope you people have understood how we can create a standalone application, how it's going to work. Okay. And then we have a lot of options here. You can just make use of this MyRio hardware to communicate through Wi-Fi itself. Okay. That is also possible. Fine. So this is how you can create a standalone system using this MyRio. See, this program is not running here. This program is not running here. That program is running inside your system. Okay, it is running executing inside your MyRio hardware now. Okay, that's why here, even though the program is not executing, the code is dumped inside your Rio hardware. We have just made it to work as a standalone system. Okay, so that's why the application is keep on running. Fine. So please let me know if you have any queries regarding this standalone application. Any doubts? So whenever you start to run, whenever you power this MyRio, automatically the standalone application will start to execute. Okay, fine. Any queries? Any queries? If there is no query, I think you have an option to reply in chat box so that I'll proceed further. Okay, thank you. I got two replies. Thanks for your reply, professors, so that I can move on to the next concept. Okay. Yes. So now, whenever you just turn on and turn off the MyRio hardware, right, this application will start to execute. So in order to stop this standalone system, okay, so you know, I don't want this standalone system to run whenever I just provide my MyRio. So what you can do is you can just go to the NI Max, you can select the MyRio hardware, you can select the MyRio hardware, and then there is an option called Disable RT Startup. There is an option called Disable RT Startup. If I just select this option, if I select the option and if I select save, automatically, okay, the standalone application will be disabled. Okay, so it will get automatically disabled, which means whenever you try to again power the MyRio hardware, the whatever the standalone system which we have dumped inside this your hardware will not work. Okay, later part, if you want to create any new standalone system and then if you want to deploy, make sure you have to use NIMAX and then you need to remove the tick mark, then only you can develop a standalone system. Because if it is selected, Disable RT Startup means, so it is going to disable the RT Startup VIs, so which means you cannot create a standalone system. So in RT, again, if you want to create, okay, make sure that this option should be removed. Okay, fine. So the NIMAX is not responding, it may take some time. Okay, so then it will disable all the RT startups inside the MyRio hardware. Okay, next step is what we are going to learn, how you can develop, okay, how you can develop a code under FPGA. Okay, so now we have done till work. And one more thing, you can ask a question, sir, if I want to read the in from system, okay, because we are giving all the commands through this RT, right? So next step is what, we can develop a code in FPGA. So if you want to have a transfer, okay, if you want to do a data transfer from your RT to FPGA, okay, so we have some set of VIs which will functions which will help us to transfer the data from FPGA to RT, as well as if you want to give any information from RT to FPGA also, it is possible. Okay, so or else if you want to do something in your system itself, okay, system, and then if you want to send an information to RT or FPGA, that is also possible. We call this actually our computer has host and your MyRio has target. Okay, so target, it has both two things. One is RT, another one is FPGA. Okay, so you can transfer the data from host to target and then target to host. Okay, fine. So these are the things you can just do with the MyRio hardware. Okay, it's not, the NMX is not responding. It will take some time. So I have to use a name. No need to give anything. Admin password. Okay, you should not give anything here. So save this. Okay, this NMAX is not responding. Maybe we'll try to develop an FPGA code. Okay, so later part. Yes, now. Okay, so why it is not doing? Because I need to connect the USB again. That is the reason. Okay, so I just removed the USB before, right? So that's why it doesn't. Yeah, now if I just click on the option save, okay. Yes, so now see it is asking, yes, I want to do change. So again, it will reboot your system. Okay, so automatically it will not make your standalone system to run. If you want to check now, okay, I've just disabled the RT startup and then I have saved, right? So now you can see my system is getting rebooted. Okay, you can check here. Once I save the option, right, my system is getting rebooted and the LED is not blinking. At the same time, the Rio hardware, okay, the NI MyRio hardware LED is also in off state. Okay, so I have just disabled the RT starter. If I just remove the option, okay, if I just remove the option and if I again just provide, if I remove the tick mark and if I save the setting, automatically that VI will start to execute. Okay, right, so now we don't want to do that, let it be, right? So next step is what? So we can check how we can do the programming under FPGA. Okay, so you can ask a question, what is it, why we have to go for FPGA? Okay, so in order to have data transfer at a higher speed, okay, higher speed, fine. Or if you want to do any process or anything in terms of nanosecond, we cannot do with RT, okay, because RT has a clock, right? So you cannot perform any application faster than the clock rate, given clock rate. So in that time, in those parts, okay, you can go for FPGA. Okay, you can develop the code under FPGA. So how actually here FPGA will work? So whatever the program we do, when we try to dump and deploy, okay, so automatically the code, whatever we do, that will be converted into bit files. Okay, that will be converted into bit files, right? So field programmable gate array, field programmable gate array, whatever the logics we are going to provide, that will be arranged in a form of gates, that will be arranged in a form of logic gates inside your MyRio hardware. Okay, fine. So if you want to develop a code under FPGA, okay, so what you need to do is you have to right click the FC. There's an option called FPGA target, right? You can right click new and then you have to select VI. Okay, you have to select VI, and now if you see here, this code is under FPGA target. See, untitled 4 front panel. Okay, this is a project name slash it is under FPGA target, which means that, okay, so you're developing a code and okay, and dumping in FPGA. So now when you just right click on the block diagram of FPGA, okay, you can see few of the functions, okay, few of the options are not visible. For RT, you get a lot of options. For FPGAs, you are getting only this much option. And if you see inside a structure also, some options will be not available because those options are not supported by FPGA-based system. And even if you see the numeric operation also, only few of the options will be available, okay, displayed, and the remaining options will not be available under the FPGA because those functions are not supported, okay, those functions are not supported by FPGA. Fine. So simple. If you want to do any FPGA core, if I want to turn off the LED, okay, an onboard LED, right? So what you can do here, see, you will not get MyRio palette, because once you started to work with FPGA, all your IOs, okay, all your IOs will be available as a node, okay, fine. That will be available under FPGA target. See, onboard, input, output, connector A, connector B, connector C. If I expand this, okay, I have LED 0, select, click, and then you can drag and you can just place it in the block diagram. See, one main advantage is what? Whenever you want to develop anything using an embedded system-based application, you will be always developing the code using embedded C programming. Okay, so when you go for this NI platform, so you no need to do anything with embedded C programming. Next part, okay, so if you're going to do anything with FPGA-based applications, so you have to stick down to Verilog or VHDL, where you'll be writing some lines and lines of code, okay? So those are not required here, because it's going to be a purely graphical based programming language, okay? Fine. So I have an LED, and if I just press the button, okay, I just want to turn on the LED, right? So even to take the onboard button itself, so you have button 0, okay, you have button 0, you can just take it, and then you can just put it in the block diagram, and you can connect it, okay? So this is your FPGA in out, okay, and this is your reference. Fine. So you have to right click, and then you need to control Z, okay? Fine. So after this, you can, if you want to give a delay, see timing palette here, even the delay is also different. You can just give, see, there is an option called ticks, microsecond and millisecond, okay? So one tick corresponds to 25 nanoseconds, which means that you can do it in terms of, we can make your application to run in terms of what? Nanoseconds. Fine. So let me give millisecond, okay? So on the timer, it's going to be 100. One thing under FPGA, okay? Here is, see, when you run the code, usually it will deploy, okay, it will get deployed in your embedded processor, but under FPGA, okay, whenever you just do an FPGA, so whatever the program, okay, so it is FPGA button, FPGA, okay, see, immediately it will not run, because FPGA, it will have what, bit files, it will get in information in terms of bits, okay. So what it has to do is, you have to convert, okay, you have to convert your code into bit files. So for that, we have some compile servers are available, okay, we have some Vivado, okay, so we have compile servers are available. So I'm going to compile through cloud, actually, because if I use local compile server, it takes a lot of time, okay. So if I just click on okay, fine, it will test the connection and automatically it will start the compilation process, okay. So we'll get a pop-up here, fine. See, it is in generating an intermediate files, okay. So the steps, whichever they use, yes, this is, these are the steps which will be happened inside your FPGA. First one is, if you just click on start file, it is going to compile, okay, it is going to generate an intermediate file, and once it goes to the Xilinx compiler, it's going to analyze, okay, synthesis, and then map is nothing but routing, okay, so map, okay, and then it is going to place in terms of gate, and then it will be giving roots, and then finally it is going to generate a bit file. Okay, if you see inside the FPGA, you will be having input output nodes, you will be having logical blocks, okay, and then you will be having programmable interconnects, okay, fine. So through that, automatically this will do all these steps, okay, this will do all these steps, and then it will see, it is in generating an intermediate file, okay. After generating an intermediate file, so it has to do all those steps, analyze, synthesis, and then it has to map, and then it has to root, then finally your bit file will be created, okay. So everything will be taken care by your respective hardware itself, okay, fine. So the compilation tool will be installed during when you try to install Labby FPGA, okay. So once the intermediate file is created, okay, yes, I think intermediate file is created, then it will start to process it. Okay, fine. So it will take around 5 to 6 minutes. If you want to compile through, see here, see this connecting to the compile server. Okay, so it is transferring the file to the compile server. You can see the options here. Okay, see 10% is completed. The only thing is the compilation takes place. So after once it transfers the file, okay, so the steps whatever seen in this slide, okay, the same thing will be done here. Here also, yes, it has transferred. See, it is waiting in the queue actually. Suppose any already bit files are available, this will be waiting in the queue. See, it is starting synthesizing. Okay, synthesizing, then analyze, and then mapping, then routing, and then finally it is going to generate an intermediate file. Okay, so step by step, all these steps will be done under this compilation process. Finally, once a bit file is generated, okay, so you can make use of the bit file whenever you want to transfer the data. Okay, so it will take around 5 to 10 minutes for the mostly it will take 5 minutes or 10 minutes for completing the compilation process. Once the compilation is done, okay, if there is no error, automatically your program will start to execute under this FPGA. Fine. So this is how you can develop the program in FPGA, and there are options to transfer. Okay, there are some functions available which will help us to transfer the data from FPGA to target. Okay, FPGA to RT. At the same time, if you develop a VA under my computer, so in that my computer, if you want to see the FPGA data also, you can have an option. Okay, to transfer the information from FPGA to your host. Okay, host means our system or laptop. Okay, fine. So it will take around 5 to 7 minutes to complete the compilation process. Okay, because it has to perform all these steps. Okay, all these steps, then only the code will get executed, because now it is under what, synthesized state. Okay, so it has generated an intermediate file, it has analyzed, now it is in the synthesizing process. Then it has to map, okay, so it has to place all the gates for the respective function, and then it has to route it. Okay, so then only your bit file will be generated. So once your bit file is generated, automatically the program will start to execute. Okay, so until that we have to wait, because yes, still it is in synthesizing phase. Okay, it takes much time to complete its deployment. Later only we can execute the code. Okay, fine. So it's okay, so our session ends by 3:30. okay, so we have enough time now. Okay, so once it gets compiled, we'll see the output. So in the meantime, I'll just make the connections for the other sensors. Okay, just to demonstrate. So, or else if you have any queries, you can ask me. If there is any doubt or if there is any query, you can ask. Because the compilation takes some time. Okay, so that in the meantime, let me use some other, see, okay, it is optimizing the logic, fine. Your synthesize step is over. So I think 50% it has been completed. Remaining, it has to place, and then it placing is started. Okay, you can see whatever the thing I have just shown in slide, so everything will be done. Okay, so after placing, then routing and mapping will be there, and finally your bit file will get generated. Okay, So if you have the bit file, okay, if you have the bit file, right, what you can do is you can, if you share the bit file to any other people, if they have LabVIEW tool, okay, so what they can do is they can have the bit file, and with that itself they can execute the code, okay. See, it is optimizing the timing. So placing is done, and then it is optimizing the timing. Fine. So last routing is there, and finally it's going to generate the bit files. Okay. Yes. So routing is also happening now. See, placing is done and routing is done. Finally, it's going to generate a bit file. Okay. The only thing under FPGA is what the compilation process will take some time, right? Okay. So apart from that, okay. So what even if you, once after compilation is done, you started to execute the program. Okay. See, it is generating the programming file. It takes around 5 minutes till now. Okay. I think it's almost going to complete. Once it gets completed, okay, if there is no error, automatically your program will start to execute, and then if you press the button, okay, it will get turned on. Now we have developed the code. Okay, now we have developed the code under FPGA. We have not done any work under RT. Okay, so that is the most important thing which we need to know. It's finalizing the programming file. It's almost going to be completed. So next, I think the bit file is going to get generated. So, and then your program will start. It will take around 7 to 8 minutes. If you go with local compile server, it may take much time. Okay. So what we will do is, so whenever you want to develop any applications, right? So if you want to do any acquisition at a higher rate, okay. So analyzation at a, analyzing part at a higher rate, only that will be done inside the FPGA. Okay. And the remaining remaining part, like data logging, everything will be done under what? RT. Okay. Because when you do more number of code, okay, when you do much number of logics in the FPGA, because which means you are going to use more number of resource under FPGA, so that the compilation takes much time. See, it has created a bit file. It is showing preparing to run. You can see here status complete, status complete, the project name, target, okay, and then it is compiled on LabVIEW FPGA cloud compile server. So this is the compilation toolkit we use, Xilinx Vivado 2017. Okay, fine. So if you want to see, okay, reports, it's about configuration. If you want to see device utilization, see it has used slice registers, you have lookup tables, LUT, okay, you have block RAM, and then you have a DSP processor. And if you see final device utilization, so total slices, okay, used, total, and then percentage, okay, LUTs, you have block RAMs, and then you have DSPs. Fine. So for estimated timing placement, estimated timing placement, it has mentioned here, okay, 40 megahertz onboard clock, requested megahertz is 40. Fine. So final timing for routing, they have mentioned here. Okay, so these are the informations. You can just look it as a report. Fine. And then you can close. See, now the program starts to execute. Now this code is under running under FPGA, it is not running under RT. Okay, so now when I just press the push button, automatically the LED will get turned on. So we used which LED? LED 0 here. Fine. So if you check now, okay, you can just see here, it's in Myrio. Okay. So we have just removed the standalone application, right? So when I just press the button, okay, when I just press the button, you can see LED 0. Okay. LED 0 is on. Okay, so now we have just done the logic inside FPGA. Okay, we have not done under RT, we have developed the code under FPGA hardware, right? Okay, so if there is any doubt, you can just ask me. Yes. If there is any query, you can ask. Any doubts? Any queries? No doubts. If you have any queries, you can just put it in the chat box. If there is no doubt, for embedded system practical, which board is to be used? For embedded system practicals, it depends upon the like stepper motor control. Yeah, you can make use of this Myrium, because we have, if you have a stepper motor driver, okay, and then if you have the motor, so you can just develop a logic, okay, so to control the motor, fine. So the next thing what I'm trying to show is, I'm going to show a demo on motor only, because I have a normal 5 volt DC motor, okay, so I'm going to just show how to control the motor using this Myrio hardware, okay, fine. So this hard, so this, you can make use of this hardware for any motor control, but the range, okay, the voltage range, everything should be in the range with respect to the hardware, okay, fine. So I have a 5 volt DC motor, so I'm going to show how I can control the speed of motor, or how I can just control the on and off status of the motor using this Myrio hardware, okay, fine. So your FPGA part, if I just show one more time, maybe the compilation, it takes much time, so that I'm going to develop the logic inside your RT only, okay. So I'm not going to do anything with FPGA again, because the compilation takes much time if I do any other programs, okay. So let me stop the code, and once your compilation is done, now again, if you just click on the run button of FPGA, again it will not go for compilation, because already the code has been compiled and the bit file has been generated. Immediately this will start to execute. But if you do a small modification or a small change, for example, placing a button from one place to another place, placing a one more control, and then if you save, again, once you have done any modification, this is like reprogramming, okay, you have done some changes in the program, so again it will deploy, okay, again it will go for the compilation process, it will do all these steps again. Once the compilation is over, it will generate a bit file, okay. So now if you see here, the bit file is generated in the folder, okay, see FPGA bit file, if I open, this is the bit file which was generated, okay, for this button logic application, okay, right. Next step is, we'll see how we can control a motor, okay, how we can control a motor using this Myrio hardware, okay, right, simple. Let me use this, fine. Yes, so now what I'm going to do, I'm going to use the same VI, okay, to develop a code under your RT. So right click, new VI. So I'm going to close the previous programs, whatever we have just developed. Okay, fine. So now we'll see how we can control a motor, okay, how we can control a motor using this Myrio hardware, okay. So now, before moving into the motor connections, I think someone is asking link, I don't know what link they are asking, fine. So let me show what are the connections we have to do with Myrio hardware, okay. So if you want to work with the motor, okay, if you want to work with the motor, you can see here, I have a 5 volt DC motor with me, okay, I have a 5 volt DC motor, okay, this motor has actually totally two pins, right, it has two wires, okay. So if you just give 5 volt, if you give 5 volt and ground, automatically the motor will start to run continuously, okay. But if you want to have a control on the motor, okay, if you want to have a control on the motor, okay, so then I have to go for hard, okay, I have to go for hardware here. And if you want to control the motor, right, so we need to use what? motor drivers. Okay, so I'm going to use what a motor driver. The motor driver is called L293. Okay, L293 motor driver. Okay, see, so you can make use of this motor a driver. Okay, to control DC motor. Okay, and then it has an option to control stepper motor also. Okay, fine. So if you use this L293 motor driver, so using this one single driver, okay, you can control two motors. Okay, you can control two motors here. If you see at the left hand side, this portion, okay, this portion, if you see, I have two MB1 and one MA2, which means that two MB1 means it belongs to one motor, one MA2 means it belongs to another motor. As I said, right, using this one driver, we can control two motors. Okay, we can control two motor, but right now I'm going to control only one motor here. Okay, so what I'm going to do is I'm going to use this one MA2. Okay, one MA2. I'm going to connect the motors at this point. If you see here, okay, I have some right hand side. If you see for me, okay, I have some input output pins. Okay, we can see here, if you see from top, input B1, input B2, enable B. Okay, and then you have ground and B plus. So leave about the B terminals because that's for one more motor. We're going to work on A terminal only. You look in, you can see there is an option called B plus. Okay, B plus and ground. You need to just provide 5 volt power. Okay, 5 volt to this respective board, then only it start to work. And then you have input A2, input A1. So that is for the direction control. That is for the direction control. Because if you see inside the IC, they have just built an XOR logic. Okay, XOR logic means what? If both the inputs are high, output will be zero. If both the inputs are low, output will be zero. If any one input is high, then only the motor will run either in, okay, if according to XOR, if any one input is high, the output is high. Okay, so in the same way only XOR gate is going to work now. Okay, so now we'll see how we can just turn on and turn off the motor using this MyRio hardware. Okay, let me give the connection and then I'll show how I have connected the motor and the driver to the MyRio hardware. Once I complete the connection, right, I can show it in my camera. Okay, fine. So now I'm going to use a 5-pin connector wire. Okay, so as I said, right, I'm going to use only one motor side. Okay, if you see, I used a 5-pin connector. So ground, B plus, input A2, input A1, enable A. Okay, so enable, all right, if enable is high, then only your motor will run. Okay, if either one input of zero, input of A1 or A2 is zero or one, then only your motor will be running because it works under XOR logic. Okay, and then we have ground and V plus is for 5 volt, ground is connected to MyRio 5 volt. Okay, MyRio DGND, and I'm going to use C port here, DIO0, DIO1 and DIO2. Okay, let me give the connection properly and then we'll see the output. Okay, once I connect it, because I cannot hold the mobile as well as this hardware together, so I'll give the connection and then I'll explain you how I have just developed, and then we are going to develop the logic. So ground will be connected to MyRio 5O or DGND ground. Okay, and then 5 volts. Okay, fine. Yes. So this is for one wire to ground. Okay. Another wire, next one is for B plus. Okay. And input A1, A2 are enabled. So I'm going to use DIO0, DIO1, and then DIO2. Okay. Always let me use 1, 2, 3. So enable wire is for 3. DIO0, 3. Okay, and then import A1 and A2, import A1 and A2, okay? So for all those terminals, I'm going to use digital input 1 and 2. So to the another end, then I need to connect the motor. Okay, so motor I'll be connecting to A1 and A2 on the another side of the driver. Now if you see, I think I can show the connection. You can see here, okay, I used motor, okay, the motor is given, right, to 1A and 1B, and if you see at this side, okay, I used the 5-pin connector, enable, okay, enable is given to your MIDAC, okay, 3rd pin. BIO03. If you see, black color is given to BIO03 and the brown and the red is given to BIO1 and BIO2. If you see here, the yellow color wire corresponds to ground and orange corresponds to power supply. See, look into the MyRio hardware. Okay, it's given to 5 volt and power supply. Okay, so this is the connection. This is the connection for your motor control. Okay, for using this MyRio hardware. We need a driver because the MyRio will not give enough sufficient current, okay, to drive the motor. Okay, next step is what we have to develop the program. Okay, so the program will be developed under RT. So to run the program continuously, let me use a while loop, and then I'm going to create a stop button, okay, and then to provide a delay, okay, to provide a delay 100 millisecond delay now. Okay, so I'm going to use three buttons. Okay, I'm going to use three buttons. One is for enable. Okay, this is for stop in the code, boolean push button. Okay, this is for input one, or we can say INA1. Okay, input A1, input one, and another one is input two. So one more boolean button. Input 2. And third one is for enable. Okay. Third one is enable. Enable is high, then only your motor will rotate. Okay. So I have input 1, I have input 2. Have enabled here. Okay, so now you have to right click on the block diagram. You can just go to MyRio palette. Okay, you can select digital out. Okay, we have to select digital out because we are going to send the command, okay, from your system through MyRio hardware. And we are using what? C port. Okay, we are using C port. So C port 1, 2, and 3. Okay, so this is for input 1. Next one, C BIO2. Okay, it is for input 2. And third one, BIO03, it's for enable. Okay, this is for enable. I'm going to give okay. Fine. So now, you can just check. Okay, so enable is given here, input 2, and this is input one. Okay, so after this, we can just run your program. So it will get deployed. Have to save the code. Motor. Okay. And now enable is on. If any one input is high, okay, your motor will rotate. Now it is rotating. I'll just share the screen now. I'll stop it. Okay. So you can see the motor rotation also. Let me make a small arrangement, okay, so that you can see the motor rotation. Just a minute. Yes. 1 minute. I'll just, I'm looking for a small a paper through which you can see the rotation of the motor. Okay. Yes. I got it now. Fine. And you can just, I'll run the code. Okay. So now I'm going to share the screen. And then parallelly, let me keep this here so that you can see how the program is running. Yes, you can see the motor is running now. I'm just controlling the motor through the MyRio hardware. Okay, so if I just click on the stop button, okay, if I just make enable off, see the program will stop because it works under XOR logic. If enable is high and if any one input is high, it rotates in one direction. Now it will rotate in another direction. Okay, see, both the inputs are high, it will stop. This is low, it rotates in another direction. Okay, so now you can see both the inputs are high. If only one input is high, it rotates in one direction. Okay, if both the inputs are low, okay, let me hold it, it will stop. Fine, now it is in another direction. So if you just click on enable off, it's a switch, it will turn off your motor execution. Okay, so this is how you can see the motor connection also. See, still it is connected. Okay, so this is how you can just turn on and turn off the motor using this MyRio hardware. Okay, so you can have speed control also. Now it is running at a constant speed. Okay, it is running at a constant speed. If you want to have a speed control, okay, so then you have to give a PWM signal. You can have a speed control also. For that, you need to give a PWM signal here. So go to MyRio. There is an option called PWM. If you just click on the option. Okay, so you can just give the PWM signal here. Now I'm going to give it through C port. DIO03, okay. So set using input express VI. So switching frequency, let it be 1000, okay. So, and then I can give the duty. You can see here, we can give the duty cycle, okay. We can give the duty cycle is nothing but on and off time period for the motor so that we can have a variable speed control. See, if my duty is 0.8, okay, 0.7, the on time is 70% and the off time is 30%, okay, fine. So if I just give my duty cycle is 0.25, 25% on and remaining 0.75%, it will be in off state, okay. So that you can have a speed control of a motor. So I'm going to set the input using the express VI, but my switching frequency, let it be 1000. So I'm going to just give okay. Okay. So already I have connected my enable pin to DIO03. Okay. So now to have a speed control, we need to give only the duty cycle. So for this, now already we have configured the third pin, right? So this you can remove it now. Okay. Because you can use only two pins and they're going through the speed control using your PWM signal, okay, right? So now I'm going to give a duty cycle, okay? So duty cycle will be in terms of 0 to 1, okay? So let me take a numeric knob control, okay? So the maximum duty will be 0.96. I'm just giving, it should be from always from 0 to 1, 0.001, okay? This is starting duty and this is your maximum duty cycle, okay? Always keep it in mind, the duty cycle will, whatever you provide, that's going to be from 0 to 1 only. So it will be in terms of 0 to 100%. For example, if you provide a 50.5 as a duty cycle, which means 50% of power will be supplied, delivered from source to load, okay? For example, if you have an LED, okay, the rated, to make it, the rated voltage is for 0 to 5. So if I just give 50% of 50, right, 0.5 is a duty cycle. So which means the 50% of power will be given, 2.5 volt will be given, so that the LED will glow at a less intensity. If you give 80% duty, which means that you're going to provide 80% of power from source to load, so that it will take around 4 volts, the LED will glow in high state, okay? The same way here also, we are going to provide a variable voltage, okay, by giving PWM pulses, so that you can have a speed control in your mode, okay, for your motor. So now, I'm going to get the knob, I'll be placing it here, okay? So now, I'm going to run the code, save. Okay. And now my duty is 0.3. Okay, see, my duty is 0.3. And let me stop this. I'll just arrange it properly so that you can see. Yes.
Sir, last 5 minutes more, sir.
This is enough, sir. I'm going to close the session within 5 minutes. No issues.
Okay, okay, sir. Sure. Thank you.
This is the last demo. Okay, so let me run the code. Okay, you can see the UT right now. Okay, see, I'll just show it in the cam. Yes. You can see the motor, okay, you can see the motor, which is running at a slow speed, right? I'm going to increase the duty. See, it is running at a faster speed. If I reduce, you can see how the motor is running at a very slow rate. Now increase the duty. See, the speed is getting increased again. If I increase the duty to 0.75, see the motor is running at some high speed, okay? So now if I just reduce the pulse, okay? So it is running at a very less speed, okay? So this is how by giving a different duty cycle, okay, you can make your motor to run at different speed here, okay. Simple example, if you are going to do anything based on robotic based applications, okay, fine, where you should have a speed control, okay, depends upon the command, right, you can make use of this PWM logics, okay, fine. So this is how by using this hardware, okay, by using this hardware, you can do n number of applications, okay. Because it has both RT as well as FPGA, fine. So please let me know if you have any queries. So we are at the end of today's session. Now it's 3:28, okay? So if you have any queries, you can just ask me, right? So this is about the NI Rio platform based system, okay? So we'll be using serials and PXIs, which is used in aerospace and avionics, research and communication, okay? If someone belongs to communication, right, so you will have, and we have a hardware called USRP Rio, okay, so where you can do your communication based experiments like SDR, a cognitive radio, and if you want to work with MIMO, massive MIMO and all, that is possible. Okay, so we have different hardwares for different platforms, right? So where you can build your real-time application through the hardware. So the most advantage is what? So no need to go on any text-based programming language. And the most powerful thing is you can interact with your real-time system during when the system is under execution, right? So with this, I'll close my session. So morning, I have just shared my number. So maybe one more time. I'm going to share my number. So myself, my name Nagraj. So this is my mobile number and my email ID. Okay. So if you have any queries regarding NI, can we connect octocoupler relays? Yes, ma'am. You can connect relays, hex keypad with 16:2 display. Yes. We have LCD display which works under UART protocol, I2C, and then it supports SPI. You can interface your LCD display. If you have keypad also, you can connect. Relays can be connected with the MyRio hardware. It is possible with the hardware. So now we have only less amount of time. Okay, we have just shown few of the demonstrations. But it is possible. You can connect or whatever these couplers, relays, whatever you mentioned, we can connect it. So if you have any queries regarding NI support, you can just reach me through WhatsApp. This is my WhatsApp number and that's my email ID. Thank you so much for attending the session. If you have any queries, you can ask me.
Yeah, thank you, sir. It's an excellent presentation from you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Clearly, practically you have shown the things very well.
Thank you so much.
Any others, if you have any queries or any questions, you can inform us. Yeah, that's okay, sir.
Okay,
thank you
sir.
Very much.
Thank you so much. Thank you, sir. Yeah. Thank you so much.
Yeah. Thank you, participants.
Thank you.